Well, welcome to today's Safe World by Design webinar. And today we're going to discuss an important topic in the area of use of new approach methods with regards to the safety testing of cosmetic products. And very happy to have Anand Osman-Ponche with us from PK Derm to take us through the presentation. As usual, we will have a question and discussion session at the end of the talk. So just think about your questions and enter them in the question box in the panel at the end, and I'll come back and join Anand, and I hope we'll have a good discussion after her presentation. So Anand, please go ahead.
Okay, thank you, Barry, for the invitation to give this webinar. In fact, this webinar is based on our last review published last week. And this review is about the established methods and new approach methodologies used in safety testing of cosmetic products. So we are very proud because it was a very huge work behind this publication, and this was done with the collaboration with my partners from Citra, from Gene Evolution, SenzaGen, and WatchFrog Laboratories. So the first question is. The review published last week in a cosmetic journal with, as I said, my partners from different companies. So the first question is why we should test the cosmetic products. In fact, there is two aspects. One of the aspects is from a regulatory point of view, and the second aspect is from business point of view. So cosmetic products need to have a proven efficacy combined with a comprehensive toxicological assessment. We know that the 7th amendment of the European Cosmetics Directive has banned animal testing for cosmetic products and then cosmetic ingredients. And we know also that the European cosmetic regulations required data to prove the safety and to support the claims of cosmetic products. So this is the regulatory part. And also, I think it is vraiment really important from a business point of view for each company. We need to avoid penalties, of course, if we don't have the relevant documentation. But what is important is to build trust with the company and with the brand. So, largely driven by regulatory authorities, a wide range of alternatives to animal testing have been developed and validated for safety testing of cosmetic products and adopted as test guidelines in different domains. Regarding the alternatives to animal testing for safety, testing of cosmetic products and cosmetic ingredients. Here we summarize which test we need at the beginning or at the late stage of the development of my product. We think with my partners who participated to the preparation of the review, we need the first test that we think it is the most important is the genotoxicity test to show at the beginning that my ingredient is not genotoxic. And if it is, that means there is going to go for the development of this specific ingredient. Then we come with a sensitization test. We need to show that my ingredient or my cosmetic product does not induce or have not any potential to induce skin sensitization. And then for mainly for the final product, I would recommend we need to show that the final product has not potential to for skin irritation or eye irritation. And according to the physical chemical properties of the molecule, we need to evaluate photo irritation or photo sensitization. And then what is also important is to evaluate the endocrine properties to be sure that our formulation or our product has not any endocrine disruptor properties. And the most important, I think, but I'm not objective with that, is to make a dermal absorption testing in order to evaluate the exposure. And all these tests are important in the determination of the margin of safety that is considered in the safety assessment of our product. So there is many models, alternative models for safety testing. We can use 2D cell culture like keratinocytes, fibroblasts, melanocytes, or other different cells from skin. We can use more complex models like 3D models of skin equivalent. For example, reconstruct human epidermis available from different providers, or more complex models like full skin equivalent with the fibroblast or including melanocytes or some immune cells. We can sometimes use a more sophisticated model like skin microtissue from InSphero. And this model is useful at the beginning for screening of molecules. And we can use at the end the excised human skin from that is for me the gold standard in evaluating cosmetic product or also dermatological product. So, according to the stage of the evaluation of the development of our product, we can at the early stage for the evaluation of cosmetic ingredients, we can use simple models or 2D skin cells for sensitization evaluation or for to evaluate anti-inflammatory activity or for aging, pigmentation, wound healing, etc. At the intermediate stage of the development for both ingredient and also finished product, we can use 3D skin models for skin irritation, sensitization, and also inflammation, aging, and pigmentation. And at the late stage, we can use excised human skin for dermal absorption testing. And also, if you are interested to evaluate metabolism or drug transporters in the skin, and also for inflammation and healing purposes. So just to let you know that at Picaderm, we have created a consortium of experts in testing of cosmetic. This consortium includes people Sensagen for sensitization evaluation, CETRA for the regulatory aspect in cosmetic risk assessment, WatchFrog Laboratories for endocrine disruptor properties, gene evolution for the genotoxicity aspect. But today I'm not going to show you all this test because I think Barry, we can organize another webinar with all my partners, and maybe that would be very interesting webinar that would be interesting for everybody in cosmetic field. So today I'm going to focus only on dermal absorption aspect because, as I said, dermal absorption is really the most important study to evaluate the exposure of a cosmetic product. So I will show you why we perform dermal absorption testing, in which sectors dermal absorption are applied, and the methodology. And I will show you not two examples, but three examples at the end. So in vitro dermal absorption, also known as dermal penetration or percutaneous penetration, because according to people, sometimes you can read in the literature percutaneous penetration or percutaneous absorption or dermal penetration, but all these terms mean the same thing, dermal absorption. So the objective of dermal absorption testing is to provide measurement of the absorption or penetration of a test article through the skin barrier and into the skin. In other words, I need to know if the test article penetrates the skin and reach the plasma, and to what extent, and how the test article is distributed in the skin. It is only in the stratum corneum or epidermis or the dermis, because this is important in terms of therapeutical aspect. So, knowledge of dermal absorption is essential for, as I said, therapeutical aspects, because the quantity penetrated can be taken into consideration to predict the therapeutic concentration at the target site in the skin tissue, and for safety issue, because quantities absorbed can be taken into consideration in toxicological risk assessment to extrapolate human exposure and calculate the safety margin. In vitro dermal absorption studies are applied in different sectors and for different purposes. In pharmaceutical industry, these studies are part of safety and efficacy assessment. This study can be used in formulation screening to select the best formulation. And also, this study is used for bioequivalence purpose, and I will show you an example regarding bioequivalence. These studies are also used in cosmetic and consumer products as they are part of safety assessment of a test item. and also in chemical and agrochemical industry, because also part of safety assessment purpose. We can use different kinds of formulation in this kind of studies. We can use cream, gels, ointments, suspension, patch, soaps, sunscreen, etc. So regarding the methodology, dermal absorption studies are conducted according to OECD test guideline 428 using France type diffusion cells. But we can use also, because I had one question, can we use this kind of study for R&D purpose? Yes, we can. We need to follow the test guideline for regulatory purpose, but also we can use this study for R&D purpose. So in this study, the test substance is applied to the surface of the skin. The skin sample is placed between two chambers, a donor one and a receptor one of a diffusion cell, which may be either static or flow through setup. So as you can see here you have an example of diffusion cell we use actually at Piquederm. We have the donor chamber, we have, you can see the skin samples, human skin samples, and we have the receptor chamber containing cell culture medium. So we can use both, we can use, so excised human skin are the gold standard in this type of study. Normally, human skin come from plastic surgeries from abdomen area. But you can also use skin from animal species like the rat or the mini pig. Normally, in dermal absorption study, we use frozen human skin because it is more easier to use frozen skin for logistic aspect from logistic aspect. But when we are interested to study skin metabolism or drug transporter in the skin, in this case, we should use fresh human skin. And we normally use free donors, skin from free donors to six donors in three or four replicates, giving at the end nine replicates or 24 replicates. 24 replicates is needed for regulatory study. So we have different parameters to control before applying the product on the top of the skin. We need to control the thickness of skin samples. We can use full thickness skin or split thickness, called also dermatomid skin. Basically, skin thickness should be less than 1 millimeter. So at the beginning, we measure the thickness of each skin sample. And we need to ensure skin barrier integrity. And for that, we measure the transepidermal water loss, as you can see in this picture, before treatment of the skin. The treatment duration in this kind of study depends on the clinical use conditions. For example, for a shampoo, we can treat street for 5 minutes and with skincare that you apply once a day. So we treat 24 hours. The amount that you apply, we use a finite dose, about 5 to 10 milligrams per square centimeter. What is important, what we perform this kind of study is a choice of the liquid receptor, because we need to ensure the solubility and the stability of the test article in the liquid receptor. Normally, we use PBS with some surfactant that help to solubilize the compound. But at the beginning, there is important work to really choose the best solution to be used. And so we need to, as I said, we need to check the solubility and also the stability before performing the study. Regarding the analysis, when we, at the end of the treatment, we analyze the test article in different compartments in the receptor liquid. That gives the indication on the absorbed dose. And we can analyze the test article in the dermis, in the epidermis, and the stratum corneum. And this to have an idea on the distribution of my molecule in the skin. And it is important if, for example, my therapeutic target is in the dermis, we should ensure that the test article or my molecule reaches the dermis. There is the different analytical method can be used to quantify or to visualize the distribution of my molecule. Basically, LC-MS/MS is the best choice to quantify the molecule in receptor liquid, but also in different compartments of the skin. And you can use ICP-MS/MS, LC-UV or fluorescence, and LSC, liquid scintillation counting for radiolabeled compound. And if I have my molecule is fluorescent, we can use fluorescent microscopy to visualize the distribution. Like as you can see in the figure in blue, we can see that the molecule penetrates in the epidermis, but not in the dermis. Can use autoradiography and also MALDI mass spectrometry imaging that give both qualitative indication, but also quantitative measurement of the distribution. I need just to say one word regarding the analytical method, because this dermal absorption studies are really complicated, complex, and because there is different several steps. Regarding the analysis, we need to ensure that we have a highly sensitive analytical method and also a highly accurate analytical method. Basically, the limit of quantification should be between 1 nanogram ml or below, because regulatory authorities, they don't accept any value tagged below the limit of quantification, because we need to show and to demonstrate that we make all our possible to have the lower limit of quantification in order to be sure that the product don't penetrate, and it is not a problem or issue with the analytical method. So it is very important to consider this part when you are performing dermal absorption study. And analytical method should be validated in every matrix, in receptor liquid, in stratum corneum, in epidermis, if we analyze in the epidermis, and etc. So I'm going to show you some example on the application of dermal absorption studies. The first example is not a bioequivalence study, but it is skin distribution. And this example is just to show you how the distribution can be different between two molecules. So I choose one molecule with very low dermal absorption rate and one molecule with normal or high dermal absorption rate. Regarding the experimental condition, in this study we use full thickness skin human from human skin from three donors. Each condition was performed in triplicate. What is important is the treatment duration was 24 hours at 32 degrees, and we analyzed the compound in epidermis with the stratum corneum, in dermis, and in receptor fluid in order to get the distribution. We analyzed with the compound using validated HPLC method. So here is the result. So the two molecules I'm going to show you are adapalene, used for acne treatment, and benzoyl peroxide or BPO, used also for acne treatment. You can see in blue the distribution of adapalene. So as you can see, adapalene is only recovered in epidermis, including stratum corneum. There is nothing in dermis and nothing absorbed in receptor liquid. However, when we look at the benzoyl peroxide or BPO, we can see that the BPO is highly absorbed and is distributed in both epidermis and dermis. So you can see in the same study, on the same skin samples, that two different compounds have very different skin distribution. The other example is an example of bioequivalence. The objective is to compare two finished products, one marketed one and one new formulation for bioequivalence purpose. The experimental procedure was the same, except that we use in this study six different donors. And you analyze the samples in total skin. We didn't look at skin distribution. We wanted just to compare total skin and receptor liquid. So, and this is this was a regulatory study. So we need to measure or to evaluate the mass balance to be sure we are in the acceptance criteria. So you can see that mass balance was within the acceptance criteria, 100 plus and minus 20% for both marketed and the new formulation. Here you have the distribution of the test article in the formulation, in the marketed one. in total skin absorbed dose in the receptor liquid, and the total penetrated dose is the sum of total skin plus absorbed dose. When we compare the marketed formulation with a new formulation, so we can see there is no statistical difference between both formulations. So the conclusion from this study was that both formulations, the current marketed one and the new one, are considered similar. Both formulations are equivalent in terms of total penetrated dose, absorbed dose, and total skin. This can be can lead to get the conclusion that similar efficacy and tolerance at the action site can be similar with a similar safety profile. So overall, the new formulation should be as safe as the marketed one in terms of systemic absorption with the same efficacy. And the most important conclusion from this study is the waiver of clinical trial. That means this study can help to not perform a clinical trial to show bioequivalence. I think this is the last example. This is an example of a cosmetic active ingredient. And the objective of the study was to measure in vitro dermal absorption of an ingredient formulated in three different products with three different concentrations, in order to make a safety assessment analysis. The experimental procedure was equivalent with the treatment duration of 24 hours. The analysis was performed using LCM-SMS method. And we analyze in total skin. We didn't get distribution profile and also receptor liquid. So here the results we can get regarding the three different formulations. We can see that the concentration of cosmetic ingredient penetrated the skin was proportional to the concentration in the formulation and does not exceed 10% of the applied dose. From this study, dermal absorption data were used in toxicological risk assessment to extrapolate human exposure. At the end, I have a lot of examples of in vitro dermal absorption, and I'm sorry I cannot show all these examples. The aim was to show you what is important to know in this test, and what kind of results can we obtain, and if you want to know more about this essay, please don't hesitate to contact us at pikederm.com. You have you have my email address, and I would be very, very happy to help you. So thank you very much for your attention.